Welcome to Selected Shorts, a celebration of the short story, Wartime Lives. Robert Olen Butler's story, Mother in the Trenches, read by Kathleen Chalfant.
With a world full of foolishly dangerous men, what's a mother to do? Like all the mothers of the world, I am stuck with the barbarian Kaiser Wilhelm, a man full of himself but as hollow as a souffle, and that well-meaning fool of a schoolmaster, Woodrow Wilson. I have known men like this all my life, being around preachers and teachers and also around my father, rest his soul, who was himself a bit of both. Men who are certain they grasp things that no man can grasp for certain. And Black Jack Pershing, another kind of man, like the one I married, a man with quick, sure hands, I'd wager, and a single-minded bond with other men under whatever flag it may be, American for General Jack and my own Jack. And there's nothing in the world to weaken that bond or soften those hands. My son is a man, too, according to the Selective Service Act. But God help me if I'll let him be a man yet, without a fight. This is something I know like any mother knows. The boy is not fully a man if I can remember so clearly lifting his wee body up and placing it on a rectangle of cotton, clean from the boiling pot and warm from the sun, and I swaddle him up and hold him against me, and he is gentle and he is quiet, and I carry him away, carry him through the world. And all the while, he is taking in the things I know as his mother, as a woman, but cannot say, cannot even put into words, except to hold him close and whisper softly to him that he is a good boy, and I love him. They eat rats. I have heard people speak of this. They live in foul water, so their feet swell and rot away. They cannot sleep for fear of the guns. They kill each other. My son was taken away to this kind of life. And so I packed a bag because my husband Jack was dead of influenza now and could not stop me, and I boarded a ship and went to Paris, and I hired a man who had already paid for all this madness of other men. One of his arms was merely a stump from the early days of this war. And he drove me in a cart into the countryside, and we slept in the fields along the way, and it was June, and there was no rain, and he spoke a little English, and on one of the nights, as we neared the front, he said from the dark a ways off behind some other tree, "Madame, you look at your son, yes?" I knew what he meant. "Yes," I said. "We." There was a long silence, and then he said, "You are mother of me also, yes?" "I have my hands full," I said, which I'm not sure he understood, but he said no more. I could hear a very faint thumping on the horizon down the road. The next day there was a thin stream of civilians passing us. Most of them had already left this place up ahead, I assumed. These refugees had no sense of urgency, as one might expect, but moved with a terrible weariness about them. A mother on foot, carrying her infant, lifted her face as we passed, and her eyes seemed very old, though she was quite young. She was perhaps as young as my son. I could have been the infant's grandmother. I glanced over my shoulder as we passed, and she, too, had turned her head. I looked before me again. Edward was my only living child. Private Edward Marcus Gaines of the 108th Infantry, 27th Division, Company such and such. I had it written down in his letter. In a trench, in a place in France. He had no infant child. He and I faced something together here in this foreign place. The end of our blood. I thought of the young woman we'd passed and of holding her child, just for a moment. Stopping the cart, and she would have stopped too, and I would climb down, and she would come to me, and she would say, perhaps in her own language, but I would know what she meant, "Here," she would say, "hold him." And so I would, and then I'd give him to his mother, and I'd say, "Carry him off now. Quickly." There was a smell of burning in the air. The cart creaked in the ruts of the road. With each turn of the wheel, there was a sound as if it would break. This one-armed man next to me muttered under his breath, I assumed, to his horse. The explosions had ceased up ahead. I drifted into sleep, and for a time I was in Yonkers, tending my roses, and the morning was bright and quiet, and it was hot already. It was summer. The air hung heavily about my shoulders. In the dream, it was only me and the roses, and I was clipping the faded heads. I worked steadily, but the garden was full of dead roses. The scissors chinked and chinked with a sound like a turning wheel. And I awoke to tents passing and the rumble nearby of motorized vehicles with armor plating upon them. And I got down from the cart and found my way through a trail of foolish men who were astonished to see me, but compliantly helpful. And at last I was with an officer who had the authority to deal with my needs. We sat on reed chairs in a tent that smelled of grass and earth. My son had written, "Mother, the men suffer here greatly, those who have been here a long while. These are the French and the British and the Australians, mostly where I am. I'm filthy already, though it's all right because I feel like one of them." This colonel before me was not filthy at all. He was quite properly clean and starched, and his uniform rustled with gentility as he leaned forward and offered me tea. "You found the right place," he said, sitting back and holding his own cup with a steady hand before his face. "But I must ask you why. What is it that you wish to do here for your son?" I had not put the question to myself with this sort of bluntness. The colonel reminded me of my husband. I had learned long ago with Jack to be prepared for the direct question. But he would ask for answers that were rarely as simple as he wanted them to be. I had not prepared myself for this similar moment with a stranger. I sipped my tea. The colonel waited, lifted his own cup to his lips. After both our cups settled back in their saucers and I kept silent for a moment more, he asked, "Are you opposed to our entry into the war?" "I am an American," I said. "I am a patriot, as is my son." "I'm sure you are," the colonel said. He nodded very faintly to me. His face was long and heavily jowled, the face of a man with grandchildren. I was still trying to find an answer to his question, for myself as well. "I know there are things that need to be done," my son wrote to me, "and I'm glad to be the one to do them instead of another fella. But I have always spoken the truth to you, Mama. I'm afraid."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.